My name's Sasha. This is my very first video abstract, and today I'm going to talk about honeybees. I took a cartography design class, and in that class, we got to choose any topic that we wanted to map. So, of course, I knew I wanted to map about the environment. Something that could relate pollutants, ecosystems, climate change, information such as that. So I knew, you know what? I'm going to do a map about honeybees because honeybees are important. They can relate all these different topics and kind of give us one idea to talk about it. So I began searching the web and I came across a couple challenges. It was a little bit difficult to find the information that I needed. And so I came across a website called beinform.com. And on that website, they had an interactive map. It was pretty cool, and that's where I collected all of my data from. I would say that I misunderstood the map the first time. I definitely made a couple of maps that didn't really make sense, that broke a couple of rules of mapping. And so I decided to kind of reevaluate, relook over the data, relook over my Excel sheet, and decide, okay, what kind of breaks can I use for this data? So I can use proportional symbols. So I can use a chloropleth map to, you know, describe different hues. So lesser being kind of lighter hues and darker being an increase of something or kind of showing those relationships. So I used quintile breaks, decided to kind of categorize the data that way. So that means that each collection of data is pretty unison. So there's the same amount of states within each category of the data. So for each symbol for the proportional symbol map. So it's pretty cool how I decided to organize it. That was another challenge I faced. I made a couple maps, a couple different layouts, and decided that I really wanted to share a story coming from the bottom to the top. And so that was a challenge that I faced, something that, colors had to play a role in that selection and the different layer options that I would use for those components. So I'm pretty excited to actually talk more about why honeybees are disappearing and kind of go in depth a little bit more about these maps. So let's take a peek a little bit further. We can see, you know, just on these maps in this relationship, I was trying to demonstrate, you know, maybe like a decade in time, in a time span. So decided to do 2011, 2012 to 2019 to 2020. And we can see like that increase in colony loss in that chloropleth map on the bottom. We can see that like increase. So the lighter colors in 2011, 2012, and then the darker colors in 2019, 2020. And as we kind of move our way up, we can see the sizes of colonies. So showing that relationship, because without understanding the size colonies that we have, it's a little bit difficult to further in depth describe the percentage loss. So that's a little bit about the relationships between the maps. As far as honeybees, we need to talk a little bit more about why honeybees are important. So you can value the reason why they're disappearing and why that's something that's important for us to understand. So we can talk about the fact that honeybees are responsible for $15 million worth of food annually for humans. That's a lot of food. In other words, 3/4 of the crops we as humans eat. That is a lot of food that honeybees are responsible for. And so what honeybees do, they're little insects and they go from flower to flower. They collect pollen on their back. And as they do that, they go into the next flower and they kind of release some of that pollen, and that's what allows the flower to reproduce. So without pollinators, flowers can't reproduce, and we lack a lot of diversity in that sense because they create that diversity amongst the forest, amongst ecosystems. They're what allows plants to travel from place to place. So that's why they're really important. So we can see in areas that have increased urbanization, maybe have, you know, an increased percentage of colony loss. We can talk a little bit about why that's happening. You know, pathogens can also influence the population of colonies. So we can see that Vero destructor is a parasite that's become very popular amongst beekeepers. A lot of people are aware of it. A lot of people decide to treat for it. However, in areas that people decide not to treat for it, that is allowing this parasite to travel from host to host, from colony to colony, and causing, you know, colony populations to decrease. And, you know, parasites are really smart. They've been around for 500 million years, okay? And they don't ever provide any benefit to their host. So we can automatically know that a parasite affecting the bees, that's not something that's good. So we can see that along the urbanization. We can also talk about deforestation. So areas that have really dense populations, more buildings, often have less food for honeybees. So that can also influence the amount of resources that we have. So we can kind of go into even more detail and talk about areas that have had exceptional or severe drought increase. So we can talk about California, states along the East Coast, areas that have had more drought and less resources for bees. We can see that that has influenced the decrease. Another thing we can talk about is the Corn Belt. So, you know, along Iowa and those areas, you can see an increase of, you know, colony loss along those areas. I was doing a little bit of research myself and I came across a researcher from Harvard, and they had done a paper and they had talked about neonicotinoids, which is a pesticide that is commonly used, definitely used in crops. And so we can see that neonicotinoids can influence the way that bees communicate with one another. You know, bees rely on that unity of all working together and communicating as one colony. And their language is much different than ours. Their language is a chemical balance between, you know, conversations. They're talking about chemicals. We're talking about hydrocarbons. This is the way that they communicate amongst each other. And so when you throw in a new chemical, like a pesticide, like a neonicotinoid, they've seen abnormal behaviors, neurologic abnormalities, such as bee nurses deciding that healthy larvae is not healthy anymore. They're not able to communicate, and they're taking that larvae and just removing it from the hive, causing, you know, colony collapse disorders. And that's a major issue. So we can see that along the Corn Belt potentially. And so I think that these maps can share so much information with us, and they can kind of let us know what's to come in the future. And the main reason why this is so important is because if we didn't have honeybees, we would have to pollinate all of our food by hand. All of the crops that we eat, we would have to do it by hand. And you know what? We will starve. And so when the honeybees go, so do we.